It's always a pleasure to speak at Melbourne Uni, one of my favorite places in the world, to discuss. Yes, it's hard for me to describe myself as coming from a particular place, because even though I was born in New York, I've been traveling on every habitable continent of the world for over 30 years. And I've lived in so many places, it's hard to keep track of them. As I was sitting in the back, I heard someone next to me in the row saying how she's from Norway. And I said, oh, yeah, I used to live in Norway. I used to be a permanent resident of Norway. So that, as well as 20 other places in the world. So in my travels around the world and in my studies, I've noted that there's a problem in what we should value these days. There's a saying that these days people know the price of everything and the value of nothing. Our culture today is very price-orientated. But actually, what is of intrinsic value for a quality life? There's not much discussion about that in a deep way. Naturally, we have discontent amongst many with the global consumerist lifestyle. But what actually is the alternative? Often, we're told that, well, we should be getting more into relationships, because relationships are more satisfying than just gross acquisitions. We're going to look at things from a different angle today. Creative self-deception. Let's consider, how much is reality really a valued commodity for us? How much do we really value reality and being for real? Perhaps you can remember staring into someone's eyes and saying, I'm for real. But what does that mean? If we look at the history of psychology, we find that in the past, there was this notion that to be a psychologically healthy person, you should be able to be in touch with reality, quote unquote, as it is. The more you were in touch with reality as it is, the more psychologically healthy you were said to be. That was the old times. Now, there has been a surge of research, not fully agreed upon, but nevertheless a prominent surge, which puts forth that actually everyone's an illusion to some degree, and a bit of illusion is healthy. Positive illusion. Especially in today's career success, consumerism-orientated world, to think in illusion about yourself and those around you leads to healthy, measurable, quantifiable results in terms of career success, luxuries, social mobility. There are three key areas of illusion, three key illusions, which there's not much disagreement that everyone buys into these three key areas of illusion. Number one, positive illusions about yourself. Generally, to live life as it generally is lived these days, you need an overinflated conception of yourself. You need to think that in many ways you're a bit cut above your peers. This is a common psychological tendency called self-deception. It's a term coming from social psychology, mostly. You consciously or unconsciously consider that your peers are lesser than you, and you are better, somehow or other. This is such a common underlying psychological tendency. So this self-deception, is it good? Is it bad? Because for careerism and consumerism, it's naturally energetic, energizing to view yourself as having unique talents that can get the job done. But that's just one key area of illusion in reference to the self, overappraisal of yourself. The second key area is in terms of how much is under your control. You have an inflated conception of your powers of control and what actually is up to your discretion. And the third key area of illusion is in terms of the future. Positive illusion means you have an overly optimistic vision of the future. Then what statistics will show is normal. Now, are these three key areas of illusion good or bad? This is the debate. We've already discussed how the classic psychological view is that the more for real you are, the more psychologically healthy you are. The more you're in contact with reality, quote unquote, as it is, the more healthy you are. But that's old time. It's old fashioned. Now the question is, how much illusion is healthy and how much is an overdose? We're going to approach this subject matter from the viewpoint of the ancient yoga texts of India, which quite decisive about the need to eradicate illusion from life. You'll read so many ancient texts which tell you that illusion is like darkness and true knowledge is like the light. So therefore, you should come out of the darkness into the light. One popular mantra amongst yogis, Om Agena Timilandasya Gananjana Shavakaya Chakshu Lalitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha. I was born in the darkness of illusion with my eyes forced shut. Not that the eyes were simply closed, or the eyelids were down, but they were forced shut, like someone who doesn't want to wake up. They forced their eyes closed. So I was born in that kind of darkness of ignorance. Yet, when I contacted transcendental knowledge, what is transcendental knowledge? Knowledge beyond simply matter, time, and space. When I contacted transcendental knowledge, as presented by transcendental personalities, a transcendental personality is one who is not conditioned by illusion, is not conditioned by the materialistic conception of life. So, by contact with transcendental knowledge and transcendental personalities, I escaped the darkness of ignorance, the darkness of illusion. And my eyes actually opened, not just physically, but in terms of spiritually. That means not religious belief, but the ability to detect the spiritual reality as primary and the material reality as secondary. How much of illusion is healthy? It depends on what kind of culture you're embracing. If you embrace a consumerist culture, then naturally, the more upbeat you feel about yourself and your consuming potential, the more you'll be able to succeed according to consumerist parameters. Obviously, if you're thinking in terms of career success, then you need to think that you have unique skills, you have powerful abilities that simply need to be facilitated. So in a materialistic society of consumerism, the more overinflated your vision of yourself, the better, it would seem. The more optimistic your vision of your future, the better. The more you think things are under your control and your decisions will actually make a major difference, it would seem that's better. Let's give an example of the second key area of illusion, thinking things are under your control. Now, when you look at ordinary psychology, how does this appear? Games of chance, or any activity based on chance. For example, someone playing dice, when they want to roll a high number, they shake the dice very vigorously, as if the more you shake, the more chance a high number is going to come out. Or if they want a low number, they very gently shake the dice, because that way the gently shaking brings about a low number. Or let's say you're on a winning streak in some kind of game of chance, cards or dice, sometimes even breathe on the dice, breathe on the cards, just to personalize the experience, as if your concentration will influence the outcome, that the outcome will continue to be favorable. So these prime areas of illusion, remember, overinflated conception of the self, exaggerated sense of control, and overly optimistic forecast of the future. These are said to be healthy in a materialistic society. The only question would be, how much is too much illusion? Not whether illusion is good or bad, but a little dab will do you. Some illusion is very healthy. And the idea is there that if you become too much in illusion, society will automatically regulate you. You'll be turned maladaptive. You are too much inflating your self-value to the point that you're obnoxious. People can't stand to be around you. Psychological tests have shown that for persons who have too high self-enhancement, people actually like to be around those persons in the beginning. But after about the seventh or eighth encounter, people become repelled. Oh, you're too egotistic. You're just too much into yourself. But for a while, people like it. And temporarily, those persons are seen to do well in their careers for a while, until they run out of steam. And such high self-enhancement persons are known to run out of steam, to even start doing well at the uni and then drop out. It's surprising. One would think that the higher your vision of self-enhancement, the more successful you'll be. But it doesn't work out like that, according to statistics. So, can society protect us from too much illusion? Can a society which is based on illusion, now this is the question the ancient yoga texts will ask, how can a society that's based on illusion protect you from too much illusion? So, what makes a society based on illusion? The ancient yoga texts, particularly the Krishna texts, like Bhagavad Gita, explain that the first major symptom of an individual and society in illusion is that you identify the body and mind as the self. If we look at Bhagavad Gita, there we see, in just chapter 2 of that classic text, Krishna explains that the problem the central character is having is that he has identify himself with matter, and therefore he's unnecessarily undergoing so many personal crises, both internally and externally. So Krishna gives a complete lesson about how the real self is an indestructible particle of spiritual consciousness that doesn't change, although the body is always changing. This is an example about how no degree of illusion is actually tolerated in the Vedic texts, in these ancient yoga texts. The human life is seen as an opportunity to liberate spiritual consciousness from encasement in matter. So, in other words, human life is seen to be, through the yoga texts, through that lens of the ancient yoga texts, human life is seen to be a combination of matter and spiritual energy. And the goal of human life is to liberate the spiritual consciousness from influence by matter. So as long as the conditioned person is identifying with matter, how can that person be genuinely satisfied or fulfilled? In other words, if I'm not matter, then how can matter satisfy me? Why should I struggle so much to acquire matter, whether in the form of luxuries or other persons' material bodies and minds? Because I think I'm matter, because I've subjected myself to that illusion, it's natural then, quote-unquote natural, that I will seek to acquire so many matter arrangements, whether in the form of silicon chips or plastic or iron or copper or flesh or even psychologies. From the viewpoint of the ancient yoga texts, mind is also matter. There's no question about mind over matter. Mind is a subtle version of matter. So you can either play with physiology or you can play with psychology. But neither can satisfy you. What is that real you? In the yoga texts, such as Bhagavad Gita, the real you is described by the Sanskrit word atma, which means a unit of spiritual consciousness that inhabits the body. And it doesn't change, although the body is always changing. And that unit of spiritual consciousness, precisely described as infinitesimal, meaning so tiny, is meant to exist in a relationship with the infinite consciousness. You heard the word Krishna. Krishna refers to the infinite source of unlimited pleasure, the infinitely attractive spiritual consciousness. So, we, the tiny units of spiritual consciousness, are meant to exist in relationship with the Supreme Consciousness. And through exchanges, personal exchanges with that Supreme Consciousness, we're realistically enhanced without deceiving ourselves that material arrangements are to some degree going to make us happy. From the viewpoint of the ancient yoga texts, civilization is meant to propel human beings toward freedom from material entanglement and development of their original spiritual attraction for the ultimate source. So therefore, from the viewpoint of the ancient yoga texts, such as Bhagavad Gita, no degree of illusion is tolerated. No degree of illusion is considered healthy. The human life is considered a chance how to climb out of the mud completely. There's no question of, well, a little bit of illusion is healthy, it'll get you through the day. No. Determination for achieving total clarity, that is the goal of human life as given in the ancient yoga texts. So how does this fit in with society today, in which when you think about it, and please do think about it, trying to be completely for real is not valued so much. I don't know how many of you, when you applied for your entry into Melbourne Uni, saw a question on your online application, are you for real? Or, what are you about really? Or, what do you think reality is? No, there are no such questions. People would consider that's meant for the philosophy department, and of course philosophy departments are shrinking and becoming non-existent these days. Why try so hard to be for real when modest amounts of illusion are shown to have positive effects in a material society? And since we live in a material society, we should take on those ingredients that make us successful in a material society. That means self-enhancement, overestimating yourself, overly appraising yourself, thinking you have more control over what's around you than you actually do, and number three, having an optimistic, overly optimistic vision of the future. One thing is very interesting. According to psychological tests, those persons who have a most, I don't want to say realistic, but have a most accurate perception of reality are persons who are clinically depressed. As long as they're not depressed too much or their anxiety disorder is not too much, they actually have an on-the-level expectation of what the future will bring and how much control they have and how valuable they are in terms of abilities as persons. If they go too extreme, of course, they think everything is out of their control and they're completely worthless and the future is horrible. But a modest amount of clinical depression produces the most accurate appraisals of one's self, one's future, and your abilities to control. We're not recommending, of course, anyone become clinically depressed, although it's fast becoming the number two disease in the world as measured by disease impact, according to the World Health Organization. We don't recommend it, though. Therefore, illusion seems to have a positive role. But what kind of society does illusion have a positive role? If you consider yourself material, then naturally you want to be upbeat about material life. I can get it, I'll succeed, I am going to enjoy with my body and mind. You're optimistic that, well, let's be precise with our yoga technology here. You're optimistic that the correct sense objects are out there for your sensory enjoyment. Sensory/sensual enjoyment. The correct sense objects are out there. You just have to meet up with them, connect with them, and grapple with them. And you'll generate happiness by the contact between your material body and mind and some other material object, whether a body, a mind, or some kind of luxury item. In this way, you feel upbeat. It's out there. I just have to connect with it. My chance will come. There'll be setbacks, of course. There'll be failures, but keep on going. One day, I'm going to get all that I'm due. The world owes me my share. In prosperous countries, there's something known as the concept of the just world. Environmentalists have real problems with this. in terms of trying to tell people about the truth of climate change and its impact. This problem was experienced at the Copenhagen meetings held a few years ago. The meeting started out by showing a film video of children suffering because of climate change. And later, upon evaluating the response of the general public, not the response from those who are environmental activists, but the response from the general public was negative. They turned off, like, wait a minute, these are children, innocent children who are undergoing suffering. What about my climate change? Now, my worldview doesn't allow me to consider that. In other words, I've bought into the just world syndrome, in which the world doesn't give suffering except to evil persons or persons who deserve it. And children are innocent, they don't deserve to suffer. So therefore, my mind turns off when I see that you're trying to teach me about climate change by using examples of innocent persons unjustly suffering. Now, I can't accept that. So environmentalists have had to cope with this, that persons have a certain degree of illusion. And unless you, shall we say, accommodate yourself to that illusion, they're not going to listen to you. So now in the environmental movement, there's a big discussion. How much doomsday should we be? How bleak should we present our assessments? Should we really tell the truth about how the impact is very unsettling? Or maybe it's too much for people, because people feel that they're good and those around them are good, and disasters should simply happen in third world countries. So this is another example about how illusion is felt to have some kind of positive value. You don't want to rattle people's cage too much. Just like if we look at the ancient yoga texts such as Bhagavad Gita, which is the prime one, Krishna says things which are unsettling. Krishna says, for example, in Sanskrit, Bhagavad Gita is in Sanskrit, Tukalayam Shastratam, this material world is a temporary and miserable place. So some philosophers, upon reading such statements, they say, oh, these Vedic texts are very life-negating. But that so-called life-negating is only about illusory life. It's not about the real life, as Krishna presents in Bhagavad Gita. The real life is the life of the spirit soul, the Atma. That life is unlimited in terms of potential, unlimited in terms of lasting enjoyment and fulfillment. So we have to discriminate then between material negativity and spiritual optimism. One is criticized by the yoga texts. I meant to say that material optimism is criticized. Material negativity is praised, but not that someone goes around just being a killjoy. Everything is miserable. Everything is horrible. Everything is temporary. How can I really enjoy? That's just one side. But the spiritual side is unlimitedly bright. So therefore, the emphasis is how to extricate the spirit soul from material illusion. And then there's unlimited room for genuine optimism. But as long as we consider I am matter, then we're trapped. We're trapped by time. We're trapped by dissatisfaction. Because how can matter satisfy non-material beings? We're trapped by the need to imagine, I'll be happy, I'll be successful, it's going to be all right. Even though our life is so time-bound, the material happiness that we long for constantly eludes us. If we accept material life as it is, it doesn't mean that we are negative. Because there are two things coming at us together. And this is what Krishna presents in Bhagavad Gita. There is the material reality, which is like the shadow, the illusion. And there's the spiritual reality, which is like the light. So the whole purpose of human life is how to get out of the shadow into the light. Even though they exist side by side, the shadow and the light, we're not meant to be in the shadow. Actually, for those who want to know, the shadow and light come from the same source. The shadow is giving an opportunity for those who want to be an illusion. Because there can't be love between the tiny particle of spiritual consciousness and Krishna, the Supreme Consciousness. There can't be love without choice. So therefore, Krishna emanates an energy of illusion just so you can have a choice, so that there's not forced love. When we talk about the love supreme, which is the pinnacle of the yoga system, we're not talking about anything forced. There has to be a choice. So, part of that choice is the energy of illusion, the shadow, in which we can think, I am matter, and I'm going to enjoy by connecting with matter. It's that kind of illusion that we want extinguished if we're going to achieve the ultimate success of human life. So, and therefore, no degree of illusion is acceptable. It can only be acceptable if you have material goals. But what of what use are material goals? One last point from Bhagavad Gita. There Krishna explains, the wise person does not delight in temporary pleasures which have a beginning and end. Knowing that so-called pleasure has a beginning and end, what intelligent person could partake of them? In other words, you have better things to do with your energies, your time, your intelligence. Sometimes someone would say, well, look, even though it's temporary pleasure, yeah, it's something, you know. Might as well grab on to what you can get for the moment, even though it's momentary. But that will not satisfy the real you, which is non-material. And therefore, why should a non-material entity waste time with material illusions? We have better things to do. That is Krishna's invitation in Bhagavad Gita. You have better things to do than cavorting with temporary matter. Reconnect with the source, and then there's real enjoyment in the loving exchange between the Atma, the particle of spiritual consciousness, and the Supreme Consciousness. Thank you very much. Might there be any questions? We'll try to answer them. I went a little deeper today than I expected, but this is Melbourne Uni, so I get inspired by the caliber of our guests. Yes.
You were speaking about how we seek sensory stimulus to satisfy ourselves.
Yeah.
And I kind of see a parallel between seeking some sort of spiritual satisfaction beyond the material world. That's something you can aspire to, something you can look forward to and go, when I can connect with this, there will be satisfaction. Then I will be happy, or however you want to.
Yes.
And in my mind, there could be just as much discontentment in seeing that as an object to attain as well. And I'm just curious, in just thinking about that, I find it hard to think of myself as something other than matter. I mean, there's more to me than my body.
Give me one thing to hold on to here. It's hard for you to think of yourself as...
I should say that I can't see the matter that makes me up, being my body and mind, as not part of me. Mm-hmm. I can't say, to state that I am not my body and mind doesn't gel with me, just because I feel that it is part of me. I feel there is more to consciousness and that it is not the only thing to satisfy, that just because I do have a body and mind, that I'll find contentment in life by satisfying my mind and my body through sensory inputs, through aspirations, through physical pleasures, but I still see that they are a part of myself. But what I wanted to ask though was that given that in any case in our consciousness we are aware that we have a mind and a body, how are we to live and be present with that in ourselves and this part of ourselves that we are aware of, if we are going to view it as not part of ourselves or not something?
Can I stop you right there? Because you've given me a real mouthful. I have to chew on it, you know. Okay. In the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna gives a very ingenious example that just like you wear clothes and you change them, similarly, you, the non-material particle of spiritual consciousness, change bodies. So, clothes, I'm wearing saffron silk, you're wearing blue, I don't know what the fabric is, but we change clothes. We're not the clothes. Whether those clothes can refer to ethnic identities, nationalities, what have you, gender, our bodies are coverings. So therefore, you would not expect me to say, I'm really going to get some pleasure out of this silk cloth, it's me. If you would doubt my mental faculties if I thought like that. Similarly, Krishna points out in Bhagavad Gita that anyone who thinks that the body is the self has, to say the least, missed the point. Because the body is always changing. We should look at what doesn't change, even though the body is always changing. It used to be thought that brain cells don't change, that the brain cells you have at the time of birth are what stick with you all your life. That's no longer accepted. Everything material is in a state of flux. What is it about you that doesn't change amidst all that flux? What is that core abstract sense of identity that doesn't change? Now you may say, well, that sense of self arises from matter. Oh, that's a big jump. How consciousness arises from matter. There's no scientific proof of that. Science is based on experience, but experience is something that conscious entities have. So therefore, the first thing Krishna asks you to focus on in Bhagavad Gita is the non-material nature of consciousness. That is your in. That's your path inwards to the spiritual reality. The fact that consciousness is so difficult to understand materially lets you know that there's a non-material reality. So let's go back to the example of clothes. You change clothes. So similarly, Krishna says, you change bodies. You're like outer garments. And that includes the mind also. As I said earlier, from the viewpoint of the ancient yoga text, there's no meaning to mind over matter. Mind is considered matter. It's called subtle matter, as opposed to gross matter of the body and its structures. So it's easy then, once you see the body as clothes, to detach yourself from it. That doesn't mean you ignore it. I am not my clothes that I'm wearing here, but that doesn't mean I neglect to take care of my clothes. It's just I don't think that they're going to bring me fulfillment. That's all. I have something else to do. Just like conventionally speaking, someone who wears clothes has other agendas than to be trying to get stimulation from the clothes. The person takes care of the clothes, but they don't base their hopes for fulfillment on squeezing pleasure out of the clothes. Similarly, someone who's wearing a body, who has knowledge, who's enlightened, doesn't think that my goals in life are to enjoy the body. In fact, the real purpose of the body is as a tool for enlightenment. That's the whole purpose of real yoga. The purpose of real yoga is not simply for physical fitness. No, it's for using the body and mind to achieve the non-material reality. So you can use illusion to achieve reality if you know the proper technique. That's the real purpose of the yoga system. How to use the temporary to achieve the eternal. How to use what is illusion to achieve what is real. Because actually, both the illusion and the non-material reality come from the same source. So I hope in some way I could answer your question, which was a very good one. I thank you. Yes?
I understand when you talk about the illusion of the self, and when it's inflated, when it's overinflated, it's undesirable. I understand that. And I also understand that the interaction of myself with my sensory self with matter is also unsatisfying, because I feel that. But the alternative you talk about, which is connection with your spiritual side or spirituality, I'd like to understand that, because I have a problem with that. My concern is that not also, and perhaps even a greater illusion? What is this spiritual side that you talk about? I can't trouble connecting with that.
Yes, of course. What are you studying here?
Physics.
Physics, yes. So, let's say there would be a time when I would have trouble with physics, especially with quantum mechanics, because the so many of the top quantum mechanics scientists say that anyone who says they understand it in terms of what it's implying, they're lying, because it's so mind-blowing. So I could say that, well, I have trouble dealing with physics in terms of its implications. First of all, its implications for the macro world, let's just speak of the micro world. But then you, because you're studying that full time, you'd say, it's possible. For example, I know one physics teacher at Harvard who said that it takes 7 years to prepare the mind of a quantum mechanics student to properly deal with the mind-blowing concepts and realities that they're dealing with. It takes 7 years to kind of reformat their hard drive in their consciousness. So there's a process for everything. This is my point to you. Just like there's a way to deal with physics, there's similarly a way to deal with the non-material realities. Everything depends on proper technique and proper technology. So Bhagavad Gita is not a book of beliefs. It's a book of spiritual technology. And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is inviting you to enter the spiritual, the non-material laboratory and make the tests. Now you might say, well, then why doesn't everyone do it? Well, not everyone's interested. You might say, well, why doesn't everyone study quantum mechanics? Not everyone wants to do that. But for those who are interested in this spiritual technology, the laboratory techniques are there. Nowhere in Bhagavad Gita does Krishna ask you to believe. This is our fear. We don't want to become true believers. Everything in Bhagavad Gita is about how to be a true experiencer. Therefore, the first thing that Bhagavad Gita deals with is consciousness. Conventional science as we know it. What to speak of quantum mechanics is all about the perceiver, the observer. So if science, as you know it, is based on experience, then we have to deal with the experiencer. So if you look at what I'm saying as an invitation to enter the spiritual laboratory, then I think it makes sense. But if you look at what I'm saying as an invitation to accept religious beliefs, then no. You don't agree with that, and I don't agree with it also. Okay? Thank you. Very good question. Let's see. Anyone else have questions? I don't want to ruin our lunch that we prepared for you. You know? Yes.
I was wondering if the consciousness that you're speaking about, which is, you know, the unit, if you think that that would be within animals as well.
Within what?
Other beings, apart from human beings.
Definitely. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains that this non-material particle of consciousness pervades all bodies. Just that different bodies allow different manifestations of that consciousness. The human body allows the most complete manifestation of consciousness. Other bodies dim the light, so to speak. It's like you have an electric bulb, and you can cover that electric bulb with light shades of different density. So the human body is the least dense. It allows the most of the original light to show. But other bodies, like animal bodies or plant bodies, they don't allow the same manifestation of consciousness that a human body allows. So yes, the yogi sees with equal vision. The true yogi sees all living entities as having consciousness. Therefore, the true yogi is very careful about interactions with all living entities. You have to eat, but why not eat in such a way that minimizes pain to living entities? Plants don't have the same degree of consciousness as animals. Anyone who has a pet, how can you deny that animals have consciousness? They like to be petted, they like to be treated nicely. They eat, they sleep, they procreate, they defend themselves. But their consciousness is not as developed in terms of what the body allows as human bodies allow. That's why you don't see dogs and cats here sitting and asking questions. Therefore, to make a long story short, if we misuse our human consciousness to chase after what is so easily available for the animals, like the cats and dogs, we have made a major mistake. And what is the proof that we're making a major mistake? Human beings have become the first species to successfully destroy its own habitat. That means we've missed the mark. We're way off the point. We become a geophysical force that's destroyed its own home, its own environment. How are we doing for time? Let me ask our program managers, because I don't want to ruin the treat that we have prepared for you.
5 more minutes, Max.
5 minutes, that's his way of saying 2 minutes to me. All right, last question.
Just to go back to your response to the first question. Are you saying that the Atma, the spiritual aspect of our lives, is continuing? So no matter how many times we change the clothing that is our bodies, that spiritual aspect is all continuing?
Yes, that is the basic understanding, the elementary understanding of the yoga system. There is something about you that doesn't change, although the body and mind are always changing. The purpose of life is first to connect with that real you, and then to understand that that spirit self, the Atma, is part of the Supreme Consciousness, and connect in the relationship between the individual particle and the unlimited Supreme Consciousness. And we're motivated to do that because that ultimate source, that Supreme Consciousness, is unlimited pleasure. That's what Krishna means. The unlimited, all-attractive reservoir of pleasure. I thank you all for brilliant questions. And now please relish the vegetarian lunch we have prepared for you. Thank you very much.